Like mysterious lights out of the darkness of the unknown, at least so they seem to us, the UFOs, the flying saucers. As real as they may appear at the time, they are nevertheless intangible illusions between fantasy and reality. Most scientists, however, remain skeptical. They speak mostly of unexplained phenomena, of optical illusions, or refer to the secret research carried out during the period of the Third Reich. A documentary of mystical stories. What's more, these phenomena are even mentioned in the German Armed Forces technical manuals. As a matter of fact, the world's first reported UFO sighting seemed to confirm this theory. On the 14th of December, 1944, Reuters reported in the New York Times, "A mysterious illuminated ball is the latest Nazi air warfare weapon. This means that towards the end of the Second World War, Germany was in possession of a secret weapon which displayed all the typical characteristics of a UFO. Our quest for German UFOs has been extremely difficult. We gathered together mysterious reports and stories, underground literature, photographs, sketches, and fragments of handwriting. And we tried to make contact with individuals who had been involved with the former secret societies Thule and Friel, as well as the Black Sun organization. One person we encountered would only say, 'Those who know do not speak. Those who speak do not know.'" The first part of our puzzle took us to pre-First World War Vienna, where all sorts of esoteric, occult, and Sumerian ideas and material were circulating. Ideas which would later be taken up by the Third Reich, and with them the vision of a new and unconventional technology. It was a period which witnessed an enormous blossoming of various secret doctrines and orders. Templars and Rosicrucians, Illuminati and Freemasons, Anthroposophists, Theosophists, Neo-Templars and Armanen. Some of them seemed suddenly to have woken up after a centuries-long sleep. What had disturbed their slumber was this: the impending arrival of the prophesied New Age, the changeover from the Age of Pisces to the Aquarian Age. Every one of these groups felt themselves called upon to make their mark on the approaching era. At the beginning, heretical theologians, as well as Oriental, Nordic, and Atlantis scholars, all worked in concert, fascinated by one goal: the new golden age. Transcending good and evil. From the beginning of time, this concept has triggered a conflict in the spiritual world between light and darkness, between white and black magic, between occultism and wisdom. Our earth and its spiritual dimensions, which are the thoughts of humanity, are the mirror of these conflicts. Each time every human being makes a decision, he is faced anew with the choice between two paths: the white road of unselfish love, or the black road of selfishness, which ineluctably leads to doctrine. Every individual who comes into contact with higher learning considers himself basically good. And yet, the two principles are still within him, obligating him to examine which thoughts and deeds he will use to serve which power. At the end of time, the twilight of the gods, he will realize that heaven and hell are our own thoughts and actions, good and evil our own invention. Then he can draw on this experience to make the journey home to completeness. The powers of darkness and light serve only one Lord, the creator of all things. They have the one goal of availing ourselves of the life experience to create a race of superior beings. Power without love can only lead to catastrophe. Back then, a young man came into contact with all these secret teachings in Vienna: Adolf Hitler. He read all the books and other literature he could find on these subjects. Hitler soon evolved a vision whereby he realized the world would have to be reforged to pave the way for a new age. The way was now marked out for the steps he would take. The sole power that seeks renewal and yet creates destruction. By the same token, this period would also see the development of positive knowledge, which would lead to the creation of a comprehensive technology. And once again, our search for clues in our quest for the alternative technology, supposedly responsible for the German UFOs, which would appear later, led us back to Vienna, to the year 1917. Four men and a woman met here in the Viennese cafe Schopenhauer. The young Maria Ortisch, a spiritualistic medium from Zagreb. The student and fighter pilot Lothar Weitz. The occultist, orientalist, and officer Karl Haushofer. Rudolf von Sebottendorf, an occultist who had recently returned from the Orient. As well as Prelate Gernot from the Order of Knights Templar. Their subject was the coming of the New Age. They spoke of secret revelations, the Spear of Destiny, the magical violet black stone. They discussed the possibility of making transmedial contact with the ancient Germanic and Babylonian deities, Ishtar Ostara and Isais, and of communicating with distant worlds, not only on this side, but also on the other. It is quite likely that this coffeehouse meeting witnessed the birth of the secret Thule Society, which in turn later spawned the German National Socialist Party, the SS, Black Sun, and the Friel Society, which in its turn gave a foundation to the occult activities of the Third Reich and the new comprehensive technology, and the beginning of German UFOs. What was the secret behind it all? The invincible source of power for them was the Black Sun. An infinite beam of light which, although invisible to the human eye, was nevertheless there and very real. Just as the bright daylight sun can illuminate the exterior, so the dark sun can light up the soul of man. It illuminates the divine light. To this very day, the occult philosophy of the Third Reich is veiled under a thick cloud of mystery and secrecy. Its leaders were drawn from the ranks of the Thule Society and the SS. In many ways, their ideas differed significantly from the accepted National Socialist Party line. Their emblem was the Black Sun. A secret philosophy thousands of years old provided the foundation on which the occult practitioners of the Third Reich would later build. The Black Sun symbol can be found in many Babylonian and Assyrian places of worship. Even the Phoenicians and the Carthaginians knew of the symbol and the beliefs that it represented. The Babylonian and Assyrian civilizations often depicted the Black Sun, the Godhead's inner light, in the form of a cross. Assyrian kings wore an insignia which in no way differed from the one more commonly known as the German Knight's Cross. This means the origin of this cross is many thousands of years older than Christianity. We have no way of knowing just what exactly was going on in the minds of the occultists of the Third Reich, and to what mysterious ends their ideas would lead them. Perhaps they believed in the ancient prophecy of the New Babylon, which would rise again in some unspecified centrally located country when the third Sargon would return. The secret knowledge and the prophecies which the Knights Templar had brought back with them from the Orient had been slumbering for centuries, waiting for the time of fulfillment to approach. In 1919, von Sebottendorf joined with Karl Haushofer and Dietrich Eckart to form the Thule Society. This was to be a melting pot of various occult orders with a network of connections throughout Germany. The center was to be in Munich. Many members of the Thule Society formed themselves in active opposition to the short-lived Socialist Republic of Bavaria. A political party was founded, and in 1921, Adolf Hitler, a man well known for his occult beliefs, was engaged as a political orator. Inspired by members of the Thule Society, Hitler's plan for a thousand-year Reich was born. The increasing political ambitions of the Thule Society resulted in a number of smaller groups going their own way. One of these groups was the Vriel Society. Towards the end of 1919, a select group of people, members of both the Thule and Vriel societies, met in an old hunting lodge near Berchtesgaden. Taking a prominent part in the proceedings for the first time was Dr. H. O. Schumann, a man whose area of expertise would today be called alternative energy. Nevertheless, the leading figure was the medium Maria Ortisch. A second medium was also present on this occasion, the 18-year-old Zigrun. Maria Ortisch presented texts she had received from her spirit medium, one in the Sumerian alphabet and the other in the secret code of the Knights Templar. Both texts had already been translated. Were they messages from the gods, or tidings from some alien civilization? Construction plans for the development of some new advanced technology which would enable mankind to reach for the stars? From now on, the members of the Vriel Society devoted themselves wholeheartedly to the realization of what must be one of the most bizarre ideas that ever occurred to the mind of man. The construction of a time machine that would transport them to the realms of the beyond and bring them face to face with the gods themselves. We don't know just exactly how far they got with their machine. The experiments carried out lasted almost 2 years. What we can say for certain is that the machine was the inspiration behind the Vriel Levitation Power Unit. At the beginning of 1924, the machine was dismantled and taken to Augsburg in southern Germany for storage, perhaps to the Messerschmitt aircraft factory. As a member of the Thule Society, Rudolf Hess gave a number of lectures and was, among others, one of the people responsible for the early encouragement this new technology was accorded. In all things, we are able to recognize two principles which decide upon matter and events: light and darkness, good and evil, creation and destruction. These two principles, the creative and the destructive, determine our technical means. Another advocate of this new technology was Victor Schauberger. "Your propulsion theory is a mistake." This statement was made by inventor Victor Schauberger, who was believed to be associated with these esoteric societies. It addresses one of the essential points of the issue. Nowadays, we would call this the search for an alternative form of energy. Back then, however, there was much more at stake, namely the quest for another science, a radically different technology. To put it simply, we could say implosion instead of explosion. The positive elements among the esoteric scholars of the Third Reich were aware that all divine creations have always been creative, never destructive. A technology which results in explosions and is based on the principle of destruction cannot therefore really be in keeping with divine intentions. All internal combustion engines, for example, whether piston engines or rocket propulsion systems, work on the principle of an explosion, in other words, with destructive capabilities. Their ultimate effect is sure to be destructive. The environmental damage meanwhile visited on the planet by the technology of explosion, including atomic energy, exhaust fumes, and so on, makes it quite clear that the call for a new technology, like the one under discussion back then, is clearly justified. Victor Schauberger's experimental flying prototypes worked on the principle of levitation. Esoteric knowledge played an ever-increasing role in the search for new sources of energy and motive power. Such research as there was particularly important in the development of electro-gravitational and tachometric propulsion. This seemed to be at the very core of the alternative technology. the energy source of the future, cheap, clean, and independent of raw materials. Two special departments, U-13 and SSE-4, were set up to concentrate exclusively on the realization of this new technology.
Die Intuition Johannes Keplers führte ihn zu dem Geheimwissen der Pythagorea.
The Johannes Kepler introduced him to the secrets of Pythagoras. Victor Schauberger's vibratory theories tied in with the traditional teachings of Pythagoras and Johannes Kepler. The monochord, an acoustic measuring instrument used by Pythagoras, demonstrates to us how the universe was created using sounds, which we obtain through a division of the sides. The entire universe was created using this principle of harmonic resonance.
Nach dem Prinzip der Obertonreihe ist der ganze Kosmos aufgebaut. Ganzzahlige Verhältnisse, Proportionen bestimmen den Aufbau der Materie.
Auch im Weltall
und in den Atomen. Das chemische Periodensystem der Elemente, die Mendelschen Vererbungsgesetze, die Blattstellungsgesetze, bei den Pflanzen, auf der Aufbau der Kristalle und so weiter. Überall, wo wir mathematische Strukturen, Proportionen haben, kommen wir auf das Grundprinzip des Monochords,
wherever we have mathematical structures and
Victor Schauberger
benutzte die Mathematik des Monochords,
um seine integrale Technik und seine Lehre von den inneren Welten, von den Schwingungen der inneren Welten
in order to develop and build upon his integral skills and his knowledge of the inner universe
and its vibrations. Ist nicht euklidisch.
One more thing,
die Geheimlehre der Pythagorea wurde von den Templerorden übernommen, aufbewahrt und überliefert.
Victor
Schauberger hat sich dieses Wissen zunutze gemacht und seine integrale Technik zu entwickeln und ist so zur Implosion gekommen. Anhand des Energieplans der Natur sehen Sie hier das Alpha und Omega, den Grundton bis zu den Obertönen bis hinauf
to the last term and ending in the creation of the entire
universe.
Symbolically, Alpha and Omega represent spirit and matter. Therefore, what we have here is something whole. This knowledge, therefore, makes an all-embracing science possible.
Implosion
is the utilization of the potential of the inner universe within the outer universe. Due to the forces of energy and evolution of science, we've been able to make great strides in the field of antimatter and with it do away with the effects of gravity.
Technik gelangen wir in den Bereich der Antimaterie und damit zur Aufhebung der Schwerkraft.
Im Juni 1934 wurde mein Vater von Reichskanzler Adolf Hitler.
In June 1934, my father was invited by the Reichschancellor Adolf Hitler to discuss his work. Hitler wanted to know about his discoveries and talk about the various possibilities and what his great plan was. And he said, yes, I'm looking for a new technology which must once again harmonize with the natural order of things, and that is my real program.
Kurz vor dem Eintreffen der beiden Reichsbeauftragten,
shortly before the meeting, Hitler, as Reichschancellor, gave the two deputies his orders. The two had come to discuss Hermann Göring's plan.
An die zwei Reichsbeauftragten vom Hermann Göring Plan. Herr Victor Schauberger, Sie werden das
and
mit
he
den
said,
Herr
Victor Schauberger, you will speak with the two Reichsdeputies, and tomorrow, or by the latest, the day after tomorrow, a second meeting will take place. And he said to the two deputies, I find the plan fascinating. Yes, we Germans will bring about a whole new science.
Wir Deutschen werden eine biotechnische Szene bringen.
Socialist Party came to power. The occult societies withdrew into the background. Within the SS, the Thule Society created a separate secret organization called the Black Sun. The Friel Society carried on much as before with its scientific research. According to reports, the Friel Society had, by the middle of 1934, created its first experimental circular aircraft to be propelled with the anti-gravitational effect, the RFC-1. The men responsible for the design and construction were Dr. Schumann and an engineer from Bochum. Since 1929, the young Gertie Vogt had been responsible for running the Friel Society, and she made herself known to private investors who were prepared to invest in projects that carried an element of risk. In the meantime, the members had become convinced that the mediumistic messages originated not from gods from the other side, but in fact, from a highly developed alien civilization within the Aldebaran solar system. The main star in the constellation of Taurus is Aldebaran. Could it be that the Sumerians, whose language remains a mystery to this day, were Aldebaranians? If they did perhaps once land in Mesopotamia, it is interesting that the inscriptions on the royal tablets tell us when the royal power came down to us from the heavens. The Friel and Thule societies were not alone in their vision of space travel in the Germany of those days. UFA, the German national film company, released a motion picture called The First Woman on the Moon. The first space rocket was then built by Werner von Braun and Hermann Oberth with UFA movie money. Many German scientists studied the possibility of traveling to the stars. Before the end of 1934, the Friel Society had built its first light aircraft, the RFC-2. Round aircraft. It was fitted with an improved Friel propulsion system and, for the first time, magnetic impulse steering. It measured hardly more than 16 feet from end to end, but it worked. It already possessed two typical characteristics of UFOs: the optical blurring of the contours when accelerating, and the colored lights depending on the level of power applied. Red, orange, yellow, green, white, blue, or violet. Despite its advanced flying capabilities, the RFC-2 remained virtually unnoticed by the political leadership of the time. The same fate was to befall the first jet-propelled aircraft 4 years later, the HE-138, the HE-176, and the HE-280. Only the SS showed a slight interest in the work of the Vriel Society. Its own Black Sun formation had meanwhile set up Research Department 4, SSE-4 for short, which was responsible for coming up with alternative sources of energy. What is certain is that their aim was to make Germany independent of foreign crude oil imports. Nevertheless, stimulated by Victor Schauberger and the success of the latest Vriel success, SSE-4 now began to construct its own light aircraft. Using Captain Hans Kohler's tachyometer converter as a basis, and appropriating many Vriel components, they developed their own Thule Aero engine. Towards the end of 1938, they had constructed a small propeller-driven light aircraft, the RFC-4, with the express purpose of observing how disc-shaped objects behave in flight. By 1939, the SS had already built its RFC-5, the first long-distance aircraft measuring more than 65 feet, and with the mysterious name, Haunebu 1. Under tight security, the Haunebu 1 made its maiden flight, in all probability, in August of 1939. Documents show that by 1941, the British had already found out about these top-secret SS experiments. In contrast to the simple Friel prototype, the Haunebu was a complicated proposition. However, because of the form of its power unit, it offered considerably more storage space. In 1939, Hitler made one of his biggest mistakes. What might have been meant to be a limited military action, the Polish campaign, led directly to the Second World War. Quite contrary to what we might imagine the situation to be in the perfectly organized National Socialist state, everyone did exactly as he pleased. The Air Force, the Army, the Navy, and the industrial concerns all followed their own inclinations. Competition for armaments contracts became intense. As a result, alternative methods of propulsion found themselves in direct competition with their more conventional counterparts. A sort of compromise was achieved with experimental flying saucers like the RFC-7.
Wir haben Transporte gemacht, auch vom Kampfgeschwader 26. Und zwar haben wir Torpedo geholt von Kiel heute
The 26th Fighter Squadron had been ordered to fly from Kiel to Norway in order to resupply the 30th Fighter Squadron, the Bamba Command. On a return flight to Hamburg, I took a model of my aircraft design with me, and taking advantage of the opportunity, actually had it forwarded to Ernst Udet in the Reichs Air Ministry in Berlin.
Zum Reichsluftfahrtministerium nach Berlin an Udet. Udet hat dieses Modell weitergegeben an Plenemünde.
Udet passed this model on to the research establishment in Plenemünde, where tests were later carried out. Over and over again, I later heard reports from people who were working in Prague on the construction of flying discs, and progress in this field was actually being made. I also knew that Habermoor and Schriever were in possession of my model and had begun work on its practical applications.
Mein Modell praktisch bekommen hätten zum Ausarbeiten, zum Rekonstruieren. Und diese Flugscheibe hat der Schriever auf seine Art, seine Gedanken
Schriever made certain alterations to my plans, whereas, as I was later for certain, Habermoor had remained true to my original design. The second prototype was a flying disc, 42 meters long, and was built by Nika Beluzzo in Breslau.
Ein zweites Modell wurde gebaut, nicht Modell wurde gebaut, ein 42 Meter große Flugscheibe wurde gebaut durch Miete und Beluzzo. Und zwar in Breslau. Und diese Flugscheibe sollte dann
This flying disc, as I discovered, was flown to Spitzbergen in Norway and should have returned to Rechlin on a directional beam with an unknown transmission frequency and code word.
Sendeskala, eine Nummer für den Sender, nicht, was überhaupt gar nicht benutzt wurde von anderen, sollte auf diesen Richtstrahl die Flugscheibe
due to a bad landing in Spitzbergen, it was damaged and was unable to complete the return flight home.
Zerstört worden, weil die ist heftig abgestoßen. Und konnte dann nicht mehr zurückfliegen.
After that, I drove into the hills just outside Prague, where the secret testing ground was supposed to have been located. I had my Leica A camera with me, when suddenly I saw such a flying saucer. I was wounded at the time, so I know that it was November, December, although the test flight was not due to take place until the following February. Someone had made an unscheduled test flight, and this is what I saw coming towards me. It had no wings, absolutely none. I took a photo and wound on the film, but it was already directly over me. Then I took a second photo, and I could see that it was a flying gyroscope, a flying saucer.
Apart from the conventionally powered flying saucers to be seen at this time, there were indeed other UFOs cruising the skies. A small Vriel RFC-2 had been in service as a reconnaissance aircraft since the end of 1940. This rare photograph shows an RFC-2 in the skies over the southern Atlantic, on the way to a rendezvous with the auxiliary cruiser Atlantis in the waters of the Antarctic. Individual sightings of the first RFC-6 Haunebu II were also reported. In July 1941, work began on this Schriever Habermoor flying gyroscope, a jet-propelled vertical takeoff light aircraft. By the end of 1942, the first practical tests could begin. However, there were serious design faults in the first prototype. The same year, Dr. Richard Mieter began work on a turbine-driven light aircraft, the RFC-7T. This was to be discus and not saucer-shaped. The Italian scientist Giuseppe Belluzzo soon joined this project, followed shortly afterwards by Schriever and Habermoor. They worked together to produce a functional, reliable light aircraft. And so, on the 17th of April 1945, Richard Mieter was able to report to Adolf Hitler, "Today, under my direction, and in the presence of three Luftwaffe officers, the V-7 was tested in the skies above the Baltic. The general characteristics and attainable performance of the aircraft were as follows. The V-7 was a supersonic helicopter fitted with 12 BMW 028 turbo aggregate engines. During the first test flight, it reached an altitude of 78,000 feet, and on the second, rose to 80,000 feet. The craft can in principle be powered by unconventional energy sources.
My background includes remote sensing technology and the exploration of the UFO phenomena. Over the years, I've had the privilege of being a friend and colleague of the late American Naval Admiral Dulfarni, who was instrumental in bringing many of the German scientists to the United States at the end of World War II. As many of you know, there was a executive order given by President Truman in August of 1945, August 15th, 45. And in March of 1946, the State Naval War Committee authorized the collection of German materials relating to experiments of high technology. The operation known as Paperclip was to bring sequestered German scientists privately to the United States in the hope that the Americans could begin a quick start, a catch-up in the areas of V1 and V2 testing. Clearly, the Germans were involved with the building of what many allies considered a miracle weapon systems. And so I have had the opportunity of looking very carefully at the documents that detail two histories. One, the building of the first space city on planet Earth known as Peenemünde, and the bringing over of some of the best technical and scientific experts in the world, headed by Dr. Wernher von Braun, which led to the placing of man on the moon. And secondly, a closer look at the lesser known development of what some experts will call the Feuerkugel, the fiery ball, or the disc-like hovercraft that the Germans were experimenting with during World War II, which was known to American intelligence and yet not really appreciated until the Germans began to cooperate with the Americans following World War II in a unified effort to advance mankind into space.
The Allies described the various German flashing flying aircraft that they saw as Foo Fighters, fireballs. The German name for the typical Foo Fighter, however, was Fliegende Schildkröte, flying tortoise, because of its resemblance to the tortoise shell on the ground. It had been developed by a specialist technical unit of the SS in the Vienna suburb of Wiener Neustadt. It was, in fact, an unmanned flying probe. Its mission was to fly close to enemy aircraft and wreak havoc on the electrical circuits. In addition, it was equipped with a special type of klystron tube. The SS spoke of death rays.
I was a fighter pilot in World War II. I served a career of 24 years as a fighter pilot in the United States Air Force. But I was a young fighter pilot in World War II, and I was a captain in the Air Force near the end of the war, and we began receiving reports sometime in 1943 of Foo Fighters, fireball fighters. They were balls of brilliant light, sometimes brilliant green and sometimes brilliant orange light, sometimes the size of a basketball and sometimes much bigger, that would get in formation with our bombers and stay there. Nothing, you couldn't shoot them down. You couldn't, no matter what maneuver we went through, they stayed exactly in position. I had friends who reported these balls of fire appearing outside of the cockpit of a fighter aircraft, only 10 and 15 feet away, and they did every maneuver they could think of, dives and rolls and everything, trying to get rid of this ball of fire out there, and it remained in exactly the same position no matter what they did. This represented a technology far superior to anything that we had encountered anywhere on the planet before. We thought these objects were being manufactured by the German government because they were our opposition at the time, and we thought they had discovered some new technique because we had already experienced other instruments, other vehicles that passed through the bomber formations at very high speed that also had glowing tails. We had close approaches of disc-shaped craft, not as close as one would like, but following bomber formations. We knew that the rockets had been perfected, and we thought that most of these were simply a further extension of this rocket technology. And we believed that they were all being produced someplace by the Germans.
Now let's return to those people who right from the start were responsible for this. In the winter of 1942, a new light aircraft circled the Friel testing ground, the Friel 1. A single-seater with an overall length of 36 feet. In other words, the dimensions of a fighter aircraft, which was what the Friel was intended to be. This also holds true for the armaments, 3 30mm caliber MK-108s and 2 MG-17s. While the Friel 1 was being developed and constructed, significant strides must have been made in the attempts to make transmedial contact. There were definite plans already at hand for the construction of a much larger aircraft, the Friel 7. In comparison to Friel technology, the Mita Belluzzo and Schrieber Habermoll projects were really still quite conventional.
The hybrid use of this technology, some investigators believe, led to the development of the commonly recognized spacecraft known as the Bolanzo, the Schrieber, the Methe systems, the first, the second, and the third prototypes of which we see here represent the most commonly seen and observed spacecraft worldwide since 1947. The documentation and personal experiences with many of the German fuel experts, however, suggest that as early as 1935, the Germans were aware that there was life and technology in the universe and were at least indirectly aware of the possibilities of building their own saucer craft, which would make them basically the first to have opened the window to contact with other areas of higher evolutionary intelligence.
Thank you. unbeknownst to those involved in Operation Paperclip, there were other scientists involved in the development of very advanced systems from the larger Honey Buell systems that were developed in 1939, 42, and 45 that could carry literally scores of officers to the Creel system, which is a very small vehicle, to a very large interplanetary electromagnetic spacecraft that was at least on the drawing boards that had cabins for sleeping. We have a prospect of a vast system that made use of underground facilities for the preparation and launching of these most unique saucer craft that literally baffled the Americans and the British.
The SS, however, had a more audacious plan. There were, at least on paper, plans for a giant Honeybu spaceship with a diameter of over 400 feet. And if the reports are correct, there was even a 230-foot-long Honeybu 3. Just before the end of the Second World War, Department SSE-4 planned to build its own gigantic UFO space station. It was to have been assembled in the old Zeppelin hangars. Its name, the Andromeda Machine. Weights of more than 100 metric tons wouldn't have posed any difficulty to the Vreel gravitational engine.
Where did the inspiration come? If we look back at the history of the ancient Near East, keeping in mind that the German philosophers were some of the best Orientalists, the work of Friedrich Delitzsch, who was one of the foremost Assyriologists, in his book Bibel und Babel, the study of Babylon and the Bible, we acknowledge a reference to flying spacecraft. We have the same concepts in the Sanskrit traditions of the Vimana. The Germans were clearly well aware throughout the history of some 12 to 6,000 to 3,000 years, depending upon Oriental and Near Eastern history, that these craft did exist, and thus began in the 30s a very intensive effort to try to look at these exotic systems that could cross, as it were, the space barrier and open the window to contact with other worlds. It's this very unique scenario, the contact with other worlds, that is the most important part of the history of the Third Reich. For how does this type of experiment arrive on the scene? That is to say, the genetic experiments. How does this type of experiment arrive on the scene? That is to say, the ability to come up so quickly with such a vast category of different space systems of flight and navigation. How does this system of a global science, that is to say, that gives German experts the ability to make expeditions to Kashmir and to the South Pole, suddenly appear on the scene? Obviously, there are higher connections.
Many expeditions were mounted before and even during the war. Not just in the Near East, but also as far afield as South America, such as this one led by Edmund Kiss. And in the remotest regions of Asia, under the leadership of the famous Swedish explorer Sven Hedin. It was the search for traces of a higher knowledge.
War mein Ziel, immer die unbekannten Teile von Asien, wo die Karten das verlockende.
My aim was always those unknown parts of Asia, where the maps bore that enticing word unexplored over the white expanses. Such were the areas of Inner Asia and Tibet that I've always sought out. That is to say, I've always had a feeling and a belief that in the middle of the desert, where there was not a soul to be found, where there were no roads, perhaps there could I discover traces of some ancient civilization.
The Vreel Society already had its own audacious plan. They got together around Christmas 1943 for a secret meeting in the German Baltic Sea resort of Kolberg. we don't know exactly what was discussed behind closed doors on that occasion, we do know, however, that one subject was right at the top of the agenda. Operation Aldebaran, on which the mediums Maria and Sigrun divulged new transmedial information. Fragmentary though these transmedial messages are, they nevertheless enable us to form an amazingly clear picture of their meanings. Even maps and landscapes of distant planets have been received by medial communication. The Aldebaran solar system is 68 light years away from the planet Earth. The magical medial telepathic agencies of the Thule and Friel societies have this to report about it. The Sun, Aldebaran, has two inhabited planets circling it. The two together go to make up the Sumerian Empire. On the 3rd and 4th of January 1944, a meeting is believed to have taken place between Hitler and Himmler. The subject of their discussion, the Friel Project, the projection of a huge Friel spaceship through the dimensional channel. In other words, a tunnel that was independent of the speed of light to Aldebaran.
If you look at human history, we see throughout the documents of Sumeria, of Ebla in Syria, even the Old Testament book of Ezekiel, chapter 1, speaks of the wheel within the wheel. So there is very clear evidence of higher and parallel evolution throughout human history. However, it is very clear that the major impact of UFO technology did not occur in 1947 at Roswell, but rather earlier by some 10 to 12 years in the area of Germany. And on the basis of looking at documents and talking with former scientists who worked in Germany during the war, it is clear that many of the officers saw UFOs in the sky over Germany during World War II, and even in the region of Peenemünde, where the first experiments took place, there's clear evidence that there were advanced electronic eyes and ears. They were watching very carefully the German scientific developments. Clearly and logically, Germany would be the most unique place for a contact that would be made by higher intelligence, since it was in the leadership of the scientific industry in the 20th century. Clearly, it was the place where some of the best scientific minds were assembled in the world.
Can we really disregard the possibility that there was an alien influence or contact at work at that time? What could this structure, photographed on the Friel testing ground in the autumn of 1943, possibly be? A Friel 7 engine being tested? Possibly. But mightn't it also be a spaceship from Aldebaran?
Now, we know that in the early parts of the war, there were certain factions of the Allied forces that did not believe he had a secret weapon. And it wasn't until the Americans made much emphasis of this that they began to look at it seriously and indeed did discover that Hitler not only had a secret weapon, he had what we would call today a UFO or spacecraft. He had one already off of the drawing board and flying, and it was capable of 1,200 miles an hour, vertical takeoff, 90-degree changes, and much like a helicopter, and of course was far superior to anything the Allied powers had at that time. Secondly, they knew that he had another craft about to be up and going. It was capable of doing 2,500 miles an hour, which was double the original. And not only did it have the characteristics of the original craft, but it also had a laser weapon aboard it that was capable of penetrating 4 inches of armor. Now, needless to say that that really spooked the Allied forces into making a redemptive attempt against him and bringing him into a state of capitulation.
What then became of all the secret projects carried out during the Third Reich? There are indeed a whole series of explanations, One is that the most important flying saucer was purposely sent to the bottom of Lake Monze in Upper Austria. Another is that they were concealed somewhere in South America and in the Antarctic. And not just that. Some people actually maintain that there is a German UFO base in the Antarctic, and that many were brought there disassembled by submarines. The most bizarre theory originates from the Special Department U-13. German UFOs are said to have traveled back in time as a result of entering a strange space-time discontinuity, where they were then received as the white gods of ancient Sumerian and Babylonian legends. Amazing tales. There is, however, something concrete to go on. Why did the Allies under Admiral Byrd mount an invasion of the Antarctic?
I would like to say that among the many scenarios, of course, was the reality that there were some 30 missing German submarines that came from Baltic port areas at the close of World War II. These submarine systems had the Valter snorkel system, which allowed them to stay under water for weeks at a time. And this advanced technology made the German U-boats some of the finest in the world at that time, as acknowledged by U.S. naval documents. It is conceivable that some of this advanced technology could have been put on the submarines, spirited out, and with the snorkel system, could have made for Argentinian ports and even the facilities there in Queen Madeleine or Neues Schwabenland. I say this as a strong possibility, having seen the film that was made in 1947 with Admiral Byrd and Admiral Wood. I had the opportunity to actually see portions of this film, and what struck me was the fact that there was a significant military contingent that went down to Antarctica with Admiral Byrd. Why was it necessary to bring some 4,000 soldiers, a battleship, an aircraft carrier, and a support team to go into an area if it was purely a geological / geophysical exploration? Clearly there were other unknown factors there, and it was up to the Americans to see if they could acquire this missing technology. That is one scenario.
After a few days, however, and the loss of an undisclosed number of aircraft, the operation was abruptly terminated. What happened? What mysterious opponent could have repelled the Allied invasion so quickly and decisively? Could it have been the few remaining members of the German armed forces? Or perhaps even aliens from Aldebaran? Admiral Byrd later explained to the press that in the event of another war, the hard facts were that we would have to reckon with an attack from aircraft that could fly from pole to pole.
Later reports indicated that Admiral Byrd was given 8 months and unlimited funding to go in and pull this thing successfully off. But we also know that within 8 weeks he was totally defeated. Now the supposition at that point was that there was an advanced civilization and technology, most probably alien. There were with the Third Reich and the SS who was in Antarctica, and that those great and developed technologies were used to defeat Admiral Byrd.
Throughout the world, in the ancient manuscripts of lost civilizations, we are confronted over and over again with tales of space-traveling gods who visited our planet to prepare mankind for a new age of knowledge and wisdom that would come about as a consequence of the next evolutionary step. The occult secret societies of the Third Reich knew of these traditions and sought ways to make contact with these space-traveling gods who had first arrived in Babylon all those centuries ago.